Brothers and sisters in Christ, good evening. Welcome to another evening of reflecting on God's Word. Last week, we started our new series on forgiveness, and we're using the book of Romans to help us to understand forgiveness and to be practitioners of forgiveness. How can we desire, long for, reach out for the forgiveness of God? And we find it difficult to forgive others. So we have received the forgiveness of God. We are to forgive others as well. I know that this is a challenging topic for many of us. And I know that sometimes it seems as if forgiving another person is the most impossible thing that we can do. I do admit that it is difficult, but it is not impossible, because we ourselves have experienced the full forgiveness of God, and all things are possible with God. So we started the series last week by looking on our need for forgiveness as we examine Romans chapter 1. And this week, we are going to be examining the theme, our attempt to earn forgiveness through the eyes of Romans chapter 2. Let me remind you that this series will take us into July, and we are doing this series with quite a number of facilitators, myself, our two lay pastors, Maxine Jones and Andrea Allen, and our dear elder, Dr. Delroy Frey. Different insights as we consider deeply the theme forgiveness. I trust and hope that you have been having a good day so far, that you have been experiencing the goodness of God in your lives. And even if things are not the way that we want it to be, nonetheless, we are here. So I invite you to relax, to have your Bibles open. Yes, it's Bible study. And even though we are not meeting physically, I just don't want you to listen. I want you to open the Word so that you can follow the Word. Write down your notes, and because we're using this method, if you have a challenge, if you have a question, if you need clarity, please do not hesitate to reach out to me. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, you are good, you are faithful, you are our forgiving God. We thank you for the way in which you're leading us at this time, as you call us to consider deeply and to be practitioners of forgiveness. Lord, we confess that forgiving is not easy to do, but we know that with you all things are possible. We pray, God, that you'll open our understanding, you'll open our hearts and our minds to this particular topic as we draw near to you so that you can draw near to us. May you bless us now through your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Yeah.
us today from Romans chapter 2, verse 1 through to 13. As I also indicated last week, we may not be able to read all of the chapters, but we will pull out the particular verses for highlight. And so we encourage you to read all of chapter 2. But I will read from Romans chapter 2, verse 1 through to 13. You, therefore, have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. For at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So when you, a mere human being, pass judgment on them and yet do the same things, do you think you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, forbearance, and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance? But because of your stubbornness and your unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath, when his righteous judgment will be revealed. God will repay each person according to what they have done. To those who by persistence is doing good, seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace for everyone who does good, first for the Jew and then for the Gentile, for God does not show favoritism. All who sin apart from the law will also perish apart from the law. And all who sin under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not those who hear the law who are righteous in God's sight, but it is those who obey the law who will be declared righteous. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Sisters and brothers in Christ, today we seek to examine the sub-theme, our attempt to earn forgiveness. And having established last week the need for forgiveness, we established last week that sin is missing the mark. Missing the mark according to God's standard, according to God's word, according to God's expectation of how we are expected to live, being in an authentic relationship with God. And so sin leads to damnation and death. And because of that, we are in need of God's forgiveness. That's the starting point, to be forgiven by God first, so that we can live our lives with God, doing God's will. And so as we experience those who have sinned against us, we are able to offer forgiveness, grace, mercy, compassion, and what we call the agape love, the unconditional love. This week, it's about our own attempt to earn forgiveness. Sin separates us from God, and we cannot be forgiven simply by our own actions or merits. We have to turn to God, the forgiver of all sins. So according to Romans chapter 2, whenever we find ourselves feeling justifiably angry about someone else's sin, we ought to be careful. And as human beings, we tend to be like that. When we hear about people doing things that are wrong, things that are malicious, things that are just out of this world outrageous, sometimes we tend to glorify in that reality, and we tend to forget that we ourselves are prone to do the same things. Yes, while we need to speak about this sin and maybe address this sin, we have to remember that we have to do so in and with humility, even as we are mindful of our own vulnerability. Oftentimes, the sin we notice more clearly in others are the ones we ourselves struggle with. Yes, because we tend to judge people through our eyes. Yeah? This is what we know. This is what we are accustomed to. These are the things that we think about. These are the things that we process. And sometimes, yes, we think that everybody is seen through our lens. And so often when we see something wrong in others, it's because they are also within us. Whether or not we're able to identify them, whether or not we're able to confess it, whether or not we're even able to acknowledge it, because we see through our lens, when we look at each other, when we judge each other, we must remember that we are vulnerable ourselves. So when we see somebody doing something, don't be quick to condemn them and judge them, because there go you and I if it was not for grace. If it was not for grace. So upon self-reflection and introspection, we can find that we are committing the same sins, the same atrocities, in more sociable, acceptable forms, in more socially acceptable forms. For example, people who gossip about other people may very well be critical of other people who gossip as well. Yeah, that's who we are, because we're able to see that same thing in somebody that we see in ourselves, as much as we may try to hide it or to behave as if it is not so. Interestingly, in chapter 1, as Paul wrote his letter to the church in Rome and highlighted and condemned idol worship, he condemned then homosexual practices and violent people, as is written according to Romans chapter 1. And I'm sure when Paul is writing and they are reading, those who feel so self-righteous and sanctimonious in the church as they received his letter, that they were nodding their heads and smiling and feeling justified and maybe making their smart comments and their smart remarks. But quickly, as Paul wrote chapter 2, he gives a warning, a very critical warning. And as the warning was to the church then in Rome, that same warning is applicable for our lives today. In other words, his warning started somewhat like this: you have no excuse. While I've identified some things in chapter 1, don't bother to glorify yourselves or to think that you are better than anybody or to think that you are more righteous than anybody. You yourself have no excuse, because you are bad as well. Paul is reminding each of us that we are not innocent ourselves. It's not only about our own interpretation about which sin is greater based on its nature. Sin is sin. In God's eyes, sin is sin. There is no little sin or there is no big sin. But we tend to make a mountain over the things that we're able to see with the naked eyes. And I'm always challenging myself and each of us that while we can see those things in the open, what about the things that are happening on the inside of us? Paul calls on us to live right and to do right at all times, in all areas of our lives. From the murderer to the molester, to the little white lie, or just simply taking what is not ours without asking, whether we are honest, hardworking, good citizens, it doesn't matter. We are all dependent on God's grace, and we are all saved by God's grace. And none of us will receive more grace than the other person. The same amount of grace that is meted out to me, it is also meted out to you. So, it is not which sin is worse than another sin. All sin lead you and I to be dependent on Jesus the Christ for salvation and eternal life. We have all sinned repeatedly, and there is no way apart from Christ to be saved from sin's consequences. Yes, sisters and brothers, too many of us think we are so self-righteous that when we hear about things that people do or they are involved in, we become so critical. And we forget that in God's eyes, little sin, big sin, however we want to qualify it, however we want to justify it, sin is sin because sin is missing the mark according to God's word, God's standards, and God's expectation of how he expects you and I to live if we are in a relationship with God. We must not lose sight that judgment will also be ours if we do not seek God's forgiveness. So we are all on repentance ground. We are all in need of a savior. We are all in need of forgiveness. To help us earn forgiveness, our faith must match our actions. It's good to believe. Yes, it is good to believe. But if we believe, what we say, what we do, or we think must add up. Our walk and talk must match. We are not only saved by good deeds, but when we commit our lives fully to God, to please God, and to do God's will, our good deeds are us being grateful to God for what God has done for us. It is not a prerequisite to earning God's grace. Let me say that again. Our good deeds, it's our personal response of gratitude to God for what God has done for us. It is not a prerequisite to earning God's grace. We are not condemned for what we don't know, but for what we do with what we know. We are not condemned for what we don't know. We are condemned for what we do with what we know. Those who know God's word and God's laws will be judged by them. And even without seeing a Bible, remember, because we are created in God's image, the Spirit of God is within all of us. What we need to do is to acknowledge it, affirm it, and appropriate it in our lives. We come into a working knowledge of Jesus Christ being Lord and Savior of our lives by repenting of our sins and turning to God. So even if we don't know the word yet, because we are made in God's image, we have what is called a conscience, which is a built-in indicator of what is right and what is wrong. But we are stubborn. So we know what's right, but we insist on doing what's wrong. And all of us find ourselves at that place. We know what's right, but we continue to do what's wrong. And it's not enough to know what is right, but if we know what is right, we're to do what is right. And that's where the struggle comes, because sometimes we are wrestling with ourselves. We are wrestling with what we desire. We are wrestling with how we feel. Yes, we know that this is right, but it conflicts with how we feel, and we give in to how we feel. And yes, we end up missing the mark. And interestingly, sisters and brothers, we fail now to live up to our own standards. So how then can we live up to God's standards? Therefore, we need to acknowledge our limitations, which is the first step towards forgiveness and healing. Yeah, we're talking about, you know, how do we earn our forgiveness? And we start by acknowledging that we need a savior. We start by acknowledging that we have limitations and shortcomings, that our very nature is to sin. Psalm 139, I was conceived in sin and iniquity. Yes, that is our nature. So we need the redemption, the redeeming grace of God. We need redemption, the redeeming grace of God to bring us on that road of forgiveness towards salvation and healing. There are many of us who tend to believe that we have religious privilege. So our status in the church gives us religious privilege. You know that? Many people come to church because it gives them status. Not because they have met the Lord. Not because they desire God and the things of God. And they want to be in a real relationship with God. Give them status in the church. And sometimes I find that people connect themselves because when they're working in their corporate world or wherever they locate themselves in terms of their profession, and they have to do a little autobiography on them, or they need to do a little profile on themselves. A lot of people love to attach to that they belong to a particular church, the status. And that's just one example. Many of us believe that we have religious privilege because of our connection with the church. You know, we grow up, so our grandmother, grandfathers, our parents were staunch members of a church, and we think that it comes down to us, so it gives us religious privilege. Encounter many people who would deserve me to do different things for them. And when I start, you know, get a little background and information of where they locate themselves personally in the church, their answer to me is always, oh, my grandmother or my father or my mother or my grandfather, you know, they used to come and be an elder there and all of that. That is them. What about you? So many people think that they have religious privilege because of that. And also, there are those who think they have religious privilege because of how they support the church, particularly financially. And that makes them above the law, above God's law. We cannot do anything we want and think that we can get away with it, because our God is El-Roi. God is all-knowing. And yes, when we come to God, we come to serve. First of all, we have to meet God for ourselves and have a relationship with God. And it is out of that relationship that we serve. We do not serve in the church for accolades. We do not serve in the church because we want people to acknowledge it constantly and talk about it. That may happen, but that cannot be our motive. At the end of the day, those things cannot save us. Those things don't render us to be forgiven. At the end of the day, we are called to be in a right relationship with God, so we can be even more mindful of our natural inclination to sin and to be separated from God. So the Jews believed that they had religious privilege. They believed that they had religious privilege. And so in verse 22, Paul is explaining to the Jews that they need to teach themselves their own laws and not others. And the Jews were good at having expectations from other people. And when I say the Jews, I'm talking about the religious teachers and leaders. Of the day. They prided themselves in the way that they look. They had a particular posture that would cause people to believe that they themselves are above the law, the religious teachers and leaders, that they had it so good with God, they got everything right. And then they would put burden on the other people to make sure that those people follow God's laws, but they themselves find excuses and various excuses why they don't think they need to follow God's laws. And so here it is, Paul, in verse 22, is pointing out to them and explaining to them that they need to first be followers of the law before they can have any expectation of others to follow the law. And the Jews knew the law so well that they had learned how to excuse their own actions while criticizing others. As Christians, we are no different. We are no different in the church. We are no different. And this is not a judgment call. It's just an observation. That sometimes, you know, we don't do right by each other. We know God's word so well that we ourselves have learned how to excuse our own actions while criticizing others. Yeah? And both the law and God's word are guidance for living according to God's will. The law and God's word is a reminder that we cannot please God without having an authentic relationship with God. I don't know why we spend so much energy on being the guardian of other people's soul and relationship with God and not addressing our own relationship with God. We spend so much energy tearing down each other for the very same thing that we ourselves are doing. And then we come across as if we are innocent. And we forget that while we can fool some of the people some of the time, we cannot fool all the people all the time. And most definitely, we cannot fool God. We cannot fool God. The law and God's word, they provide guidance for us to live according to God's will for our lives. The law and God's word is a reminder that we cannot please God without having an authentic relationship with God. Too many of us are residing on the surface. We need to dig deeper with our faith. We need to put more energy in how we anchor an authentic relationship with God and pay less attention to other people. I'm not saying that if somebody is doing something wrong as another believer, a Christian brother or sister, we don't see it as our way of caring to point out in love and good measure to, you know, to say, hey, I noticed something and I'm not calling you out on this because I'm perfect or because I've gotten it right, but I'm just wanting you to know that I care, I'm concerned, and I want to help you along the way. Let us focus on having a right relationship with God. When we accuse others, we must ensure that we are not guilty of what we are accusing others of. And Paul had an angst with hypocrisy. Yes, we love to tell others how to behave, and we ourselves fail at what we require from others. It is easier to say the right words rather than the right words taking root within us. Never require from anyone what you yourself is not willing to do. Never require from anyone what you yourself is not willing to do. Make sure your action match your words. And if you know, say, your action not match your words, shut up. Keep silent. Work on you. Work it out with God. if we belong to God. Our life should reflect what God is like. Disobeying God is dishonoring God's name. In verses 25 through to 29, Paul makes the distinction between what we outwardly do and the transformation of our hearts that will cause us to do the right thing. So a lot of people are big on doing so that others can see them and say, yeah, man, good person that. They do this, they do that. But Paul here makes a point that anybody can put on a show. That's basically what he was saying. Anybody can put on a show on the outside for people to have a particular idea of who they think we are. And Paul is challenging us that it is what is happening on the inside, the transformation of our hearts. For when our hearts are transformed, then our actions will be in line with the transformation that has taken place in our hearts. So, he had an issue with the Jews because many of them were at that time big on being circumcised because it's a sign of God's covenant with God's people. And they were not obeying God's laws. But because they were circumcised and because the circumcision represented God's covenant with them, they thought that it was okay. So being circumcised meant nothing because it cannot render any of us, it cannot render them forgiven and saved. And then the Gentiles, who they would oftentimes criticize and put under pressure, they were not circumcised. But they would have seen themselves through God's eyes and they would have repented and they would have come into a working knowledge of who God is and they would have accepted God and sought to get their hearts transformed by the work and power of the Holy Spirit. They sought to live their lives by God's standards. They are forgiven and saved. And so Paul explains that a Jew, a real Jew, one is one who pleases God. It's not someone who is circumcised, but someone whose heart is at the right place with God. Someone who is obedient to God. Right? It's the same for us. It is not what we do on the outside, but it is each of us seeking to be in a relationship with God where our hearts are at the right place with God. So to be a Jew, you were in God's family and you would have been heir to all of God's promises. Yet Paul made it very clear that membership in God's family is based on what's on the inside and not on external qualities. And this is where, as a church, we are called to get mature, because too many of us are still at the place of external qualities. And we are not seeking to make sure that on the inside, through the work and power of the Holy Spirit, the transformation is taking place. So, for us to earn God's forgiveness, we also have to make sure that our heart is at the right place with God. Yeah? Sad to say, you know, many hearts are filled with unforgiveness. Yeah. Many of us in the church here, we suffer with unforgiveness. We want other people to forgive us, but we don't want to forgive anybody. And that is so sad. We wrong somebody wrong us, but we expect that the person first must bridge the gap. No! If your heart is at the right place, take up your phone. Call that person. Say your peace, P-I-E-C-E, so that you can have your peace, P-E-A-C-E. Say your peace, P-I-E-C-E, so that you may have your peace, P-E-A-C-E. We're sitting there and waiting on. Sisters and brothers, at the end of the day, those things will not matter. Okay? It's about where your heart is with God. And you know, make no sense you sit there trying to feel good about yourself and say, I'm okay. My God and I are good. I'm working it out with God. If you and your God are good, then do the next thing and move to the next step and call the one who you think has wronged you. And you may be surprised that you have wronged them too. So you, while you need to be forgiven, you also need to forgive. And it is not all good and well to say that you forgive. Demonstrate that you have forgiven. So attending church, being baptized, seeking and receiving membership, every morning religiously, prayer partner this, studying God's word, giving praise to God, it is not enough. That's just lip service. When we are seeking to be forgiven, when we are seeking to earn our forgiveness, we have to move from words to actions. Because God desires our heartfelt devotion and obedience. Yes, sisters and brothers, God desires our heartfelt devotion and obedience. So, we're seeking to earn forgiveness. We have to first acknowledge our limitations. We have to confess who we are. Yeah? We are not good. We are seeking to be good by God's grace. That's the first step. And then we must understand that religious privilege will not help us on that particular journey. That what God demands of you and I is to have a real relationship with God. That God does not buy hypocrisy. We can't say one thing and then do another thing. As we are earning forgiveness from God, we must also remember, that it is also where we find our heart. Our hearts need to be at the right place. So, it's hard, but we are in the word, we're doing the word, and we're asking God by God's grace to allow God's word to help us to do the right thing. It is not impossible, it may be hard, but it is possible with God, So we'll pick up next week as we move into Romans chapter 3. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we come to you at this time, Lord, knowing that you know us for who we are. Lord, I know that this is a difficult study for many of us, but you are working your purpose out in our lives. By your grace, Lord, may you help us to do right, to speak right, so that we can bring glory and honor to your name. So may your word resonate with all our spirits as you continue to lead us on the path of righteousness. And so, people of God, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance unto you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Amen.
My faithful Father, enduring friend, your tender mercies like a river with no wind, it overwhelms me. Covers my sin each time I come into your presence. I stand in wonder once again. Your grace. still amazes me. Your love is still a mystery each day. I fall on my knees 'cause your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me.
Still amazing.